of localization. I will recapitulate a little bit what we did last time, so just to show you the people who were involved in this, if I can have my pointer somewhere. So David Thauless, Elio Abrahams, Phil Anderson, and TV Ramakrishnan. It seems that no photograph of Licciardello exists on the web, so I could not find him, I'm sorry. If someone has one, I'm happy to get it. Okay, so just to recapitulate a little bit what we did last time and which led to this diagram for the renormalization of the conductance. Again, let me remind you the philosophy. The idea is to say, let's imagine that we want to describe a big system, a big chunk of material which is made of a disordered material, and we want to do it by building it like Lego, by doing little blocks that we will add. So in a square, let's say I would do four blocks, then more blocks and more blocks, and I want to know how the conductance of the system is varying when I change the size of the system by adding these blocks. And one first part of the argument, which is due to Thauless, that we discussed last time, is to say that actually the parameter that will tell you how the property of the system evolve, so namely whether a particle will be able to jump from one block to the next, is entirely determined by the ratio of the broadening of the level of of one block, which is linked in a way to the diffusion properties of this block, to the level spacing, which is inherent to the size of the block. So the level spacing, which is inherent to the size of the block, it's essentially the inverse of the density of state. And the level space and the broadening of the level of the block, it's a little bit more difficult to estimate, but you can estimate it by saying, if I have a diffusion process, I use the uncertainty relation, saying that the broadening of the level is linked to the inverse of the time, h bar over the time, that it would take for a particle to go across the block. And the conclusion of this, when you put together this ratio, is the fact that actually this ratio is only a function of the conductance of the problem. So it's not a separate function of the disorder, of the density of state, or whatever, but only the conductance of the problem of the block appears. So this suggests this is an act of faith at that stage. It's not something which is a proof, but it strongly suggests that if you want to build a bigger system out of smaller blocks, the way the conductance of the problem will evolve when you change the size will entirely be determined by what is the conductance of the smaller blocks. And so you want to write an evolution equation. Let's say, of course, you immediately transform this very discrete evolution that I did where I would double the size of the system by putting four blocks together and so on into a differential equation where I would do a small increase of the size of the system by saying that the derivative of the conductance, if you want, or the log of the conductance with the size of the system would be a function of the conductance at the previous size. So this is essentially the equation which is written here on the board. And of course, the problem is that you don't know this function.
So
your g tilde is a function of the size. So g tilde is, of course, a conductance which depends on the size of the block.
Okay, it's not an intrinsic.
No, it's of course, if I take a simple system, let's say in 1D, the conductance of the problem will depend on the size. It's in 2D, it's a little bit special case because if I have Ohm's law, this size dependence naively goes away. But in 3D and in 1D, simple application of Ohm's law tells you that the conductance depends on the size. Okay, and so this equation is already something which is extremely powerful because it tells you that if you had a microscopic theory to compute this quantity, you would find that indeed the right-hand side is only a function of the conductance, which is not obvious because it could be a function separately of the disorder, of the density of state, of many, many things. Okay. And then what the gang of four, which is below, did was to say, okay, we don't know the function beta, but we can try to guess it. And we can try to guess it by thinking about what is the conductance of a problem, both when the conductance is very large, which means a very good metal, something which is not localized, in which case we hope that Ohm's law is applicable, and on the opposite limit, something which is extremely localized, so the large lambda zero case, where I would expect all wave functions to decrease exponentially, so I would expect that the conductance decrease exponentially with the size of the system. Okay? And if you do this, application of Ohm's law that we did last time immediately tells you that the conductance is proportional to the conductivity times L to the d minus 2, so the beta function is d minus 2. And if you're localized, the fact that you want a conductance that decreases exponentially with the size of the system tells you that the beta function is log of g divided by a constant. So it's negative by construction because g is supposed to be very small. It's negative if g is very small, and it's d minus 2 if g is very large. So if now you also assume the simplest way to connect these two limits, without the function doing hooks and nooks at various places, you find the following connection, let's say smooth connection, between the very large limit and the very small g limit. Now, every time the beta function is positive, you see that from this differential equation, it means that the log of g is growing when I increase the size of the system, which means my system is becoming more metallic, less, better conducting, less localized. On the contrary, if the beta function is negative, the conductance, the log of the conductance is decreasing, which means my system is a worse and worse and worse conductor, so it's getting more and more and more localized. So what you see from this guess, I would say, is the fact that if you're in d equal 1, you start from a beta function which is negative even when g is super large. So you start from an extremely good metal. You have very, very tiny amount of disorder, and you just make the system longer and longer and longer and longer. And what this equation is telling you is that the conductance of the system is getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, which, okay, initially is to be expected by Ohm's law, simply because it decreases with the size, but then it becomes worse and would become localized. Ah, sorry, then I don't know if I can do it also. Yeah, that you will see. If you don't see now, let me know, because I can make it even bigger. Okay, so you start here, then the beginning is Ohm's law, but then you would get to a lower and lower conductance, which means that the system would be localized. So it tells you that in 1D, the system would always be localized. It would always be something which would correspond to an insulator. The surprise of this is that in 2D, you would also say that the beta function is always negative, so the system is always localized as well. So it would tell that if I take a 2D object with an infinitesimal disorder, it's always an insulator, provided the size of the object is large enough. So again, here we see that there would be no delocalization transition that would be possible. And on the contrary, in any dimension above 2, you start here with a positive beta function, which means if I am anywhere here, the beta function is positive. So if I start with this conductance for my initial block, the conductance will become larger and larger and larger and larger and larger as I increase the size of the system till I go essentially to Ohm's law results, just to finish. And on the contrary, if I start here, I would get worse and worse and worse and go to the localized regime. Yep. Well, you improve the conductance because of Ohm's law, let's say. Imagine that I have a system where I forget any localization effect, the local microscopic conductivity is a number. When I deal with building my blocks, I put both objects in series, and I put also resistance in parallel. And in 3D, I have more things in parallel than I have in series. So the simple increase of the geometry of the thing makes the system a better conductor. It's a geometrical effect. Now, of course, the fact that this beta function is not just d minus 2 would tell that there is something which is detrimental to that. But in 3D, it's not enough to counteract the Ohm's law, I would say, parallelization, and therefore this is going up. And here, this is the exponential localization, which is making it worse.
Where do I see on your diagram weak disorder versus strong disorder?
So weak disorder means that you start with a G conductance, which is large. You have a weak disordered system, so the initial conductance, which is the inverse of the resistance, is very large. So if I have a weakly disordered material, I start somewhere there. On the other hand, if I have a very strongly disordered material, I start somewhere there with a very small conductance to start with. The point which is interesting is that in 1D and 2D, you see that even if you start here with an extremely weak disorder, an extremely large conductance, you would always flow to a system which is with a very small conductance when you go to a very large size. Yeah.
So the variation of the conductance with the size is a geometrical feature. But in d equals 2, if you have g and you divide by 4, for example, g, then you get g again. So it means that in d equals 2, it's only the fluctuations of g that...
So that's exactly the point of this thing. If you only had Ohm's law, then the beta function would be exactly d minus 2. So in d equal 2, it would be 0. It would simply not evolve. And that's what you're describing. But the fact that you say, I assume or I intuit, after all, Anderson is one of the authors of the paper, that there is a very localized regime that exists, it tells you that for g very small, you must have an exponential decay of the conductance. In which case, beta of g must be log of g over g0. And now, if you want to connect these two extremes, this one here, which should be on 0 asymptotically here, where Ohm's law is supposed to be valid, but here the log result, you see that you have to approach the thing from below. So it means that it will not be d minus 2, but d minus 2 minus a little something, which is not due to Ohm's law, but which is due to localization effect, and that's enough to push you over the edge. And then once you start on this slippery slope here, you just go down the hill. So the fact that you want to connect this asymptote at d minus 2, which is only valid if g is very large to start with this negative part, forces you to be below. Now, one thing which could happen, and nobody can exclude that from the arguments which are given there, is that you would have something like this. You start below, and for some reason it goes positive, and then it goes negative, where you would get two transitions. But it's less likely. So the people here did the smoothest connection they could do. You can easily draw other functions and argue that they should be the right one. But if you want a smooth connection, if you say no accident happened, then you're forced to start slightly below d equal 2 at any finite g because you need to connect to something which is negative. And you don't want a non-analyticity in the beta function, let's say completely flat, and then starting, that would be very unphysical. So you're right. The geometrical effect in d equal 2 do not give any evolution with the size. But the fact that you want a smooth beta function tells you you need to pull your function a little bit below d equal 2. Okay. Are there other questions on this? Because, yep.
So the transition from always localized to meta localized, the dimensional transition, because it might have fractional dimensions.
Yes.
Do people know? What
I'll come to that in a second. Of course, if I trust this, it would mean that as soon as I am above d equal 2, my asymptote is above the line here, and then I have a transition. So if I am in 2 plus epsilon, where epsilon is finite and positive, I should get a transition from localized to delocalized. And in d equal 3, of course, this transition I've written here, you see that if I push here my asymptote very just above here, most likely the transition is shifted to the right, which means it will happen at a larger and larger conductance. So I need a system with a very weak disorder unless I will flow to the localized regime. But it's good because then it means I can control the properties around this point, because for very large conductance, very small disorder, I can do some form of perturbation theory.
I'm thinking about
the
perturbation theory.
Yeah. So here, indeed, any dimension above d equal 2, one expects to have a metal insulator transition. That was one of the predictions of the scaling theory. Are there other questions?
In the
Thouless argument. So the heart of this is literally the Thouless argument. And the fact that you get this broadening of energy level compared to the level spacing of the blocks.
There is no classical model for understanding.
Well, I mean, it uses explicitly the Heisenberg uncertainty relation. So I don't know how to do it from a classical model. And you see that in a way, h-bar over e-square is very naturally appearing here to normalize the conductance of the problem and so on. So I don't know. I mean, this is a very intuitive argument. This is by far not this is physics with the hands, not very serious calculations. But I think it's deeply quantum in nature. No, there is H-bar.
There is
H-bar because you say that you compute the time to go through the system via the diffusion argument,
when you have a frequency omega, what is quantum is the fact that you consider an energy H-bar omega even if the omega is classical. That's where quantum is.
You get rid of the H-bar by dividing the energy by H-bar and then you get the frequency. No? Okay.
Yeah, but you use an uncertainty relation, which is delta T delta E is equal to H-bar. So. Okay, I don't want to debate on the semantic, whether it's classical or quantum, because.
But you can do the same thing for classical oscillations, mechanical oscillations.
Yeah, you can do the same thing for mechanical oscillations. But again, waves are, Schrodinger equation is a wave equation. As long as you have a wave equation, you can call it quantum mechanics or you can call it classical mechanics. Here, the fact that it's quantum is the fact that electrons in a solid or whatever will be represented by this wave equation. If you tell me I have another wave which is represented by the same wave equation, but it's a classical object, it's of course the same physics. So that's why I'm saying I think it's more a semantic debate on what is the particle and the wave you're looking at. We had a similar debate on what we should call a topological phase transition. Okay, I don't want to go in that. Other questions on this? Okay, so this is a very, very strong sort of suggestion or prediction, because it tells you that in any dimension above 2, you should have a metal insulator transition. And this transition, of course, will separate a regime where you flow to, let's say, a good metal, and a regime where you flow to a localized system. Now, like any phase transition, using the RG, you can extract and you can predict that there will be a sort of singularity or Paolo singularity around the transition. So if you're close to the transition, you can define critical exponents. So one thing you can predict is that, for example, the conductivity of the material close. So of course there will be a GC, which is the critical the critical point which separates the two regimes. And you can predict that close to the transition, the conductivity will behave as G minus GC to a certain exponent, which I will call nu epsilon. So let me call from now on the dimension and say the dimension is 2 plus epsilon, just because I want to be around D equal 2. And essentially, you can compute this exponent nu from the RG. I don't think it's worth spending too much time doing it. If you are interested, I can show you how one can do it. Let me just say that, of course, if I am with epsilon small, GC is large. That's obvious from this diagram. And so I can use a perturbative calculation to estimate the correction to the beta function, because I can compute the conductance perturbatively the same way than we did it, the same way than we did it here. You see that here what we get is a perturbative calculation of the conductivity of the problem, which goes beyond, let's say, the Drude, which goes beyond Hom's law. So if I take into account this correction, I can give the correction to the conductance beyond Hom's law, which of course is only valid if the disorder is very small. Otherwise, my correction would become uncontrollable. But if I do this, you can sweat a little bit and find that the beta function, beta of G, is D minus 2, which is, of course, epsilon, minus a correction, which is a certain constant, divided by the conductance. That's the first correction that people found to the beta function.
What is strange when you do this kind of reasoning is that G is for a given sample of a given size, depends on A.
Yes. That's the point. It's not universal in the sense that it depends, as you say, on the size of the system. But if you average over disorder, which is always what people do, I mean, in this type of calculation, for a given microscopic model, that's what you will find.
So epsilon?
Epsilon is just the D minus 2. It's just the dimension. You can show that
nu, the exponent,
yes,
nu is independent of the size,
yes,
of the system.
Yes. No, but this is for a very large system. No, so sorry, maybe again to make things precise. You here try to determine the behavior of a system of infinite size by using this procedure, which means that the behavior here that I will get around the transition will, of course, correspond to letting the size of the system becoming larger and larger. So I'm just saying, if I start from here, I will always flow here. If I start from there, I will always flow there when the size is infinite. Which means that then I can define a quantity which is valid in infinite size, like the conductivity, the initial conductivity, which is size independent. Contrarily to the conductance, the conductivity is size independent. And I'm just saying, close to this critical point, I claim that the conductivity here is behaving as some power of the distance to critical point. It doesn't matter what I take as criterion to approach the critical point. I could say I choose the energy of my wave. So if you prefer, I could write this as E minus EC to power nu epsilon by saying, oh, if I have a spectrum, for example, like this, let's say my spectrum starts here at E0, then I have a whole bunch of level for the pure system, and now I have somewhere in this spectrum the value EC, so that this is localized, this is delocalized. And then I change the energy of my wave, and I'm just saying when I will get close to this magic value EC, I will have the conductivity which will behave as this Paolo of E minus EC with this exponent. And this exponent, of course, is independent of the size of the system, meaning it's only determined in the limit of infinite size for the system.
But you understand why I have a problem, because sigma is independent of the size, and g minus gc on the right depends on the size.
Yeah, yeah, but that's, yeah. Yeah, so maybe let me, to avoid confusion there, let me do it that way. You will be more happy if I just put e minus ec to power nu epsilon. It's the g of a block of size one. Let's say it's the g of the initial of my initial problem. So if you want, as soon as I know the size of my initial problem, I can always bring it to a size-independent quantity. Okay. So I won't go into details on how you extract this from the RG equation. I will just give you the value here. If I use this beta function. Of course, you see immediately that what I was saying, that if you write that you get the transition, it means that GC is equal to A over epsilon. So the smaller epsilon is, the closer you are to D equal to, the critical value needs you to have smaller and smaller disorders. So you are let's say you're more and more easily localized. And then, using the solution of the RG equation, you can show that the exponent nu is simply given by 1 over g times the derivative of the beta function at gc. And therefore, if you work it out, you find that epsilon nu is equal to 1. So with this solution, what you find is that the critical exponent that you get for the conductivity would be essentially that the conductivity is behaving as E minus EC to power 1, essentially, around D equal to. Yes?
I have two questions.
Yeah.
So first, you're at 2 plus epsilon, so this epsilon equals E minus 2.
Yes.
This is always correct, right?
Well, that's definition of epsilon. It's D minus
so
2. A is a constant, so this is some constant that I don't want to write that you can determine precisely. It's 1 over pi square, h-bar, something like this, just some number that people know. I mean, it's not that I don't know it. I don't know it, but it, you can find it in the literature. It's, yeah?
The exponent 1 now is for D equals 3?
No, the exponent 1 is 1. Epsilon times nu. You will see why I write it that way, because I will define another exponent which will be nu directly.
So nu
is this. So let's see if it works, what I'm saying here. We could differentiate this. This would make, so my beta function, so beta prime of g, yeah, let's see if it works, is a over g square. And then I would have that nu is 1 over gc times a over gc square, which is gc over a. But gc over a is 1 over epsilon. And therefore, epsilon times nu is 1. Times epsilon, nu times epsilon. And why people did this stupid notation will become clear in 1 second. Yeah?
I thought it was a subscript.
No, that's a product, yeah.
The grid component itself should depend on the details of the geometrical details.
Yeah, so GC depends on the details of the model, of course. But the exponent is in general more universal. Like if you have a standard phase transition, the TC, the critical temperature, depends on the very precise details of the model, but the exponent is usually only fixed by the universality class, the type of symmetries that the order parameter has. And here it will be the same, in the sense that depending on which disorder you put in your problem, whether the disorder respects time reversal symmetry or not, you will get one exponent. If you make another class of disorder, not another strength of disorder, another class of disorder, for example, disorder that violates time reversal symmetry because it contains a spin orbit coupling, then you will get another exponent. So again, this technology allowed to classify the localized systems based on the symmetries or the broad class of the disorder that you have in your problem. When I say more or less, I mean it still depends on broad class of disorder. So if I have a certain class of disorder which respect time reversal symmetry, I get one value. If I have another class, it's very much universal. It's still, there are several classes for the exponent. Other questions? No? Okay. So yes, I will tell you about the case of three dimensions. Let me just tell you that people worked very hard. So if I say t is equal to 1 over 2 pi g, and if I define a function beta of t, which is minus dt d log l, which is the same equation than the one I wrote, beta of t is equal to epsilon times t minus 2t square minus 12 zeta of 3 t to the 5 plus term of other t to the 6. So this were calculation. I don't know who went to the last order, probably Ikami. And just to tell you that people have computed this beta function to quite some orders to give you the epsilon expansion of the exponent. Epsilon. Epsilon, it's here. So you can get the exponent in a series expansion in powers of epsilon. Of course, if epsilon is equal to 3, go ahead if you have a question. Do you have a question? Epsilon is d minus 2. D minus 2. So, of course, you're very happy because you get the exponent as a function of epsilon. And now you would say, what happens in d equal 3? Well, d equal 3, epsilon is equal to 1. And therefore, your series in term of epsilon expansion is not very well behaved. And it might or it might not be a problem for phase transitions, standard phase transitions. People had the same problem. You do an expansion in 4 minus epsilon. This time, epsilon is bringing us to d equal 3, for example. And you can still want to study problems in d equal 3 and d equal 2 even. So epsilon can be 1 or can be 2. And there you're saved by the fact that you know the large order of the perturbation theory, so you can do a resummation of the series, a Borel resummation or a Padé resummation. And from a series which is formally divergent, you can reconstruct the exponent with a good accuracy. To the best of my knowledge, but for localization, people do not have the same technology, which means that we do not know how to resum the series. So in epsilon equal 1, we are dead, which means there is no reliable estimate of the exponent coming from analytics.
But experimentalists are alive for 3 dimensions.
And numerical people are alive also in 3 dimensions. So I can give you a results by Bernard Kramer and Angus McKinnon. So these are probably the best numerics. So this is Report Progress in Physics 56-1469, and this is 1993. And there is a more recent Slevin and T.O. Tsuki, which is PRL 82382, and this is 1999. Oops, I think it's correct. And in d equal 3, the best numerical estimate is nu equal 1. 0.58 plus or minus 0.02. So that's the best that exists from numerical methods because, again, analytically, this scaling theory is not, I mean, if people knew how to resum the epsilon or how to properly resum the epsilon expansion, that would be a viable procedure to get exponent with good accuracy. But to the best of my knowledge, contrarily to standard phase transition, here we miss the right procedure to do the resummation of the series, which of course complicate the analysis. There are a certain number of questions. For example, what would happen if the dimension is becoming infinite? There were some papers by Efetov claiming that at infinite dimension there would be a jump in conductivity, that the conductivity would not be continuously smooth through the transition, but there were some problems with these papers. So let me say it that way. This transition here still needs a lot of explanation or needs certainly more powerful method to be able to really control it and understand it, certainly in D equal 3. And last but not least, of course, measurements would be very interesting. Again, the difficulty here, but not for cold atom people, is not to pollute the determination of the exponent with, for example, interactions between the particles, because then we are dealing with a completely different problem than the problem we have discussed so far. Okay, yep.
What is the status of the numerics in the key-crosser system?
Oh, that's a good question, I don't know. I don't know.
What was the question?
But the key-crosser, it depends which key-crosser. If you're dealing with a standard key-crosser, it's one-dimensional. So here, one dimension, it's first, it's always localized, so there is no such exponent.
I was thinking of the extension to D3.
Yeah, that I think you should ask Dominique Delande, who will know much better than I do the answer to this question. Sorry, there was another.
So is a non-integer epsilon, does that relate to a fractal?
Not really. This is just an analytic continuation of all the integrals on the dimension. Because every time you get integrals which are something like this, like dq, and then you will get things like q square, blah, 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 you can always decide that this becomes a non-integer dimension. Of course, at the end, the physical dimensions are integer. You could imagine, and people have pursued experimentally the study of localization and on fractal structure, but here it's just a tool for doing the calculation. But people have realized, I'll show an image, for example, of aerogels and put helium in aerogel pores, and there you can hope even to realize a fractional dimension. But at that stage, it's just a numerical tool to regularize the integral. It's the equivalent of the factor S that was introduced yesterday. So instead of putting it on the propagator, you put it on the integral of the dimensional space. That's, let's say, a convenience. Other questions? Okay. I think if I want to tell a couple of more things that I won't mention in too many details, the more refined techniques, because of course then this scaling theory stimulated enormously what I would call more microscopic calculations to try to put flesh on this connection of the beta function. So I will just refer to two papers. One by Konstantin Efetov, and this is archive 10.02.2632, and an old paper by Franz Wegener, which is Zeitschrift für Physik B, and this is 35.207, 1979, and both invented methods to be able to compute objects, so to do the quantum average of objects like this, or products of objects like this, So one object like this gives you the density of state, essentially. A product of object like this gives you, average of the product, of course, gives you the conductivity. And the difficulty in doing this thing is, of course, and of course you do an average over the disorder. And the difficulty in doing these things is, of course, to be able to do it while doing the average over the disorder. So I don't have the time to go into details on the methods, but if you find the name in the literature, it's called nonlinear sigma model, or it's called the supersymmetric method. And at the end, it consists in being able to do Gaussian integrals with a trick. Okay. Now, let me, in the whatever 15 minutes that I have left, discuss very briefly the case which we master the less, which is, in a way, the strongly localized regime. So when we are on this side, here, what happens? What tools do we have at our disposal? So this is essentially three, the strongly localized regime. And first, let me mention the possibility of analytical solution. When I say analytical solutions, I mean in the sense of the physicist, which means not even with rigor, but... So there, of course, there are precious few. In 1D, the situation is not too bad. There is a solution by Berezinski. The same than the one of BKT, Berezinski Costolis-Stauless transition. And it's called Berezinski diagrams. And there is a solution by Abrikosov. The same than the vortex. Abrikosov, and let me give you one reference. I should have found the reference to the original Berezinski paper, but I give just a reference to the paper by Abrikosov, which contains reference to the Berezinski diagram. And I want just to point out the limitation of these solutions. So this is Advanced Physics 27.1.4.7.78. And these solutions are quite good because they allow to compute not only the various observables, but also quite involve transport quantities, like the conductivity as a function of the size of the system, the average of the various moments of the conductivity, so the various powers of the conductivity. So these are relatively sophisticated solutions, but they are made not on a model which would be a parabolic, a particle with a parabolic a dispersion in the clean case, but they are made for a Dirac equation. So they are made for a particle which would have essentially an energy which is moving with a constant velocity and which is sort of plus or minus. So you get two species of fermions which are moving, some with right velocity plus v, some with left velocity plus v. So you could say, you could call them photons if you want. So you get plus v, minus v. And of course, the disorder is able to change the momentums and scatter one of these particles from momentum k to momentum k plus q, but is also, of course, able to change and scatter back. So in a way, you can view the first process as a particle arriving on an impurity and continuing more or less forward. And the second process as the particle arriving on the impurity and sort of going backwards. So.
But the first one is inelastic.
No, the first one is not inelastic. Well, I mean, you can, as long as you don't do it too long, you can violate conservation of energy, provided you don't do it too long in quantum mechanics. So if you get a second scattering on another impurity, you can, you're allowed to do this. So this is called the forward scattering. This is called the backward scattering. And just as a warning, if you take the model with only the forward scattering, you would get a model where wave functions would decay exponentially, but the system is a perfect conductor, so it has no Anderson localization. So it's particularly important for this model to put the backward scattering, because you see easily that the forward scattering is not stopping the particle. But if you compute the wave function, at least averaged over disorder, it will decay exponentially. The correlations of the wave function would decay exponentially. So this is a little bit complication that one has to factor into account. To the best of my knowledge, this is essentially the only analytic solutions that exist which can deal with a deeply localized regime, and they exist in 1D. Okay, then there are variants of these solutions, but I mean in D equal 2 or D equal 3, I don't know any exact analytical technique. There is an approximate, what I would call mean field technique, which is due to Vollaert and Wölfler. So it's Peter Wölfler and Dieter Vollaert. Exactly. And it's called, and again, I give you reference to a review, recent review paper that is put on the archive, 3238. And it's a self-consistent theory, which means you compute the diffusion coefficient by computing the correction with the diffusion coefficient, which you have to determine self-consistently. So you compute the diffusion coefficient as a function of the diffusion coefficient, if you want, and then you find what is the what are the solution of this equation, and you will find, depending on the strength of disorder, that there are two type of solution. One regime in which this coefficient is finite, that's the metallic regime, and one regime where the only solution is D equals zero, which means it's the localized regime. Don't expect to use this method to extract any exponent at the transition. This is a mean field method, so by definition, it cannot give critical behavior, and so on and so forth. Okay. What are the questions that one can ask? And without going too much into details. Of course, the question one could ask is, what is the shape of the wave function? And that people have tried to probe by using quantities that were already actually introduced yesterday, like the probability of return to a point R. So defining a coefficient which I will call QR, which is the limit when t goes to infinity from the integral from 0 to t of dt average of R exponential of minus iht, where h is the Hamiltonian R square, and then averaged over disorder. So this is the disorder average. So this is sort of the idea that you start with a particle at point R, you let it evolve in time, and you reproject on point R, and you try to see what is remaining at time going to infinity, and there is a 1 over t which is missing here. So if your particle is localized, something will remain. If your particle is a plane wave, it will escape to infinity, so nothing will be left. And in terms of the eigenstates, this is the sum over alpha of modulus of R alpha to the power 4, and again, averaged over disorder. So that's one quantity you can measure. And this ratio goes from 1 if you're absolutely localized. So if essentially your state alpha is absolutely localized on one single site, and it would go to 1 over the volume for a plane wave. So if the volume is infinite, it's... There is another quantity that people call the inverse participation ratio, which is essentially the sum over R of the amplitude of the wave function, whatever eigenstate alpha that you have, so it depends on the eigenstate alpha, to the power 4. I assume that the eigenstate is normalized, so the integral over R is one. And you see what is the again this inverse participation ratio. If the sort of normalization of the I have a plane wave, then the amplitude here is one over square root of the volume. So that when I take psi square and integrate over the volume, it gives one. So this object here is one over the volume. Okay. And on the contrary, if the wave function is perfectly localized around one single site, this object here is of order one. So the inverse participation ratio will vary again between one and one over the volume, depending on how localized your wave functions are. So that's one way to probe the wave function. Okay, there are relations between these two. If you assume that your wave functions are decreasing exponentially, something like this, you can kind of extract a pseudo length from the inverse participation ratio. So you could say that you have a length here, which is whatever, let me not spend too much time on the prefactors, but which you can extract. This is pi to power d minus 1 over 2. Gamma function of d plus 1 over 2, it doesn't really matter, times the inverse participation ratio to power 1 over d. So in a way, you can extract the localization length out of the measure of the inverse participation ratio also. You can also extract the localization length out of the size dependence of the conductivity of the system with the size, if you say it decreases as exponential of minus L to the xi. Oh, by the way, I realized that with the discussion, I forgot to tell you why the stupid notation here. It's because I can also define another exponent, which is the exponent for the localization length, if I can find it back. And the exponent for the localization length is that xi is again e minus ec, but this time to only power minus nu. So this is why the other exponent is nu times epsilon. It's because nu is the exponent of the divergence of the localization length. So you can want to know what is the localization length. There is something which is interesting, is that at EC, the idea is that the wave function should have a multifractal structure. So if you are exactly at the critical point, so if I define a participation ratio, which I call PQ, which is the integral ddr of modulus of psi of r to power 2q, you will find that this ratio average over the disorder is, as I said, L to the power 0 for the insulator, doesn't depend on the size of the system. It's L to a power minus tau q if I am critical. And it's L to the power minus d times q minus 1 if I am metallic. This is the 1 over omega that I was describing before, but since I've put power 2q here, I get q minus 1, which is coming here. And if I am exactly critical, then tau q is d times q minus 1, which is okay. It connects smoothly with the metallic side, but there is a correction, which people have called delta q, and which is dependent on q. So in a way, it's like having a correction to this scaling law, but which is dependent on the power you put here, which means that your wave function has extremely broad distributions of amplitudes in the system. So let me show you this, because I think it's interesting, and I will sort of stop with that. So just to show, first, let me show you that one can compute this inverse participation ratio. Here is an example of the inverse participation ratio as a function of the energy of a wave which is propagating in a 1D system for various ratio of the disorder to the bandwidth of the system. So the red curves are very small disorder. The blue curves are very large disorder. You see that the inverse participation ratio is very small here. You see that the localization length is very large here and, of course, drops at this energy. The point I want to make here is not so much the curves. They are not very important. This is some recent work we did in connection with some proposal for cold atoms with Anne-Maria Visuri and Christophe Berthaud. But the point is the numerics. Look at this. We do n equal 2,000 sites. We do 10,000 disorder realization. This is d equal 1. We're very happy. Now we try to do the same thing in d equal 2. D equal 2, we have 100 by 100, and we do 200 disorder realization. So our numerical performance is destroyed extremely fast. And believe me, we did a good work. It's not that we were lazy. So just to say that if you want to compute this quantity, we really need good tools, new tools, because the standard tools and the brute force calculation get rapidly unusable in d equal 2 and, of course, d equal 3, while this would be sort of perfect here in d equal 1. Here are also calculations of the localization length of the system as a function of the strength of the disorder. In 1D, the localization length is actually proportional to the mean free path, and this is what we find here. For small disorder, we find very nicely asymptotes that are going as 1 over v square, the disorder square, which is the mean free path. If we are in 2D, the localization lengths become exponentially large at small disorder, so they become very rapidly competitive with the type of size we can do. Here would be the curve, the analytic curve, which is here. You see that numerically we saturate very fast because we are unable to do systems which are large enough. So here again, the very large variation of the localization length in 2D is seriously challenging our ability to do calculations. Here is a picture extracted from a presentation of Sacha Myerlin of the wave function of a 2D system. And actually, this exponent of the multifractal behavior were measured using sound waves. And I don't know if Bart will talk about it tomorrow. But definitely, using ultrasound in a random, ball environment, this exponent delta Q could be measured. OK. So that's more or less all what I wanted to say about the non-interacting problem. So let me finish by mentioning, of course, that there are a certain number of questions and complications. And I'll just mention a couple of these questions. So for non-interacting, as I said, I think one needs an efficient way to compute and, of course, understand, but even if we understand qualitatively, in the strongly localized regime. Or close to the transition. Of course, when I say strongly localized regime, if the disorder is super strong, okay, it's not interesting. Everything is extremely localized. It means not too far to the transition. Not necessarily critical exponents, but just behavior of the wave function. We need, of course, detailed calculation of more sophisticated observables. It can be like transport. It can be moments of various quantities, in particular to probe self-averaging. It can be wave function properties. and so on and so forth. And I think one last question, which personally I find interesting, as I said, it's not an exhaustive list. It's my personal little wish list for Christmas, so I have to wait till next year. Effect of the other type of disorder. Well, I mean, for example, quasi-periodic. And so on and so forth, because now we know more or less what happens if we take a white noise disorder. And you would be the first to agree that if we take disorder which has more complicated Fourier spectrum, like the one of a speckle, interesting effects appear. And I don't think these effects have been explored. People have mostly focused on white noise disorder so far. And I think cold atoms in particular are excellent in stimulating theorists to think about this other thing.
And which dimension are you talking about?
Any dimension, because this kind of question could be interesting in any dimension. I just want to mention that in 1D, I can refer you to a paper by Guillaume Roux and collaborators, which is FISREVE 78. 023628, where quasi-periodic systems were studied. Okay, there are also interactions in this paper, but already the effect of a quasi-periodic potential on the 1D system. So this is Aubry-André, but you could also put Fibonacci chain and so on and so forth. This is something which is interesting. Yeah. Yes.
What exactly is the exponential decay? What happens really in very precise
terms? So Aubry-André has been well studied, but for example, what happens if you have, instead of the Aubry-André, which contains only two harmonics, you have a Fibonacci potential, which contains all the harmonics, but with a very precise structure for the Fourier component of the potential. To the best of my knowledge, there is no precise result on this. There are.
Actually, I'm not sure what you're talking about, but it's not the same thing. But the Fibonacci sequence, actually, there's also some work, right?
There are works. At least I know physics work, but I don't know mathematical work. That's my ignorance. Yeah.
I speak of mathematical work that is also giving a very precise.
Okay, good.
Not only of the spectrum, right, of the spectral type. I mean,
yeah, spectrum is. Yeah, but for example, is transport computed for this?
I don't think they compute any macroscopic functions.
Yeah, so the spectrum is whatever, singular, continuous, and things like this. So that I
local spectral data, yeah, right? Yeah. Not only the spectrum, but also yeah. The eigenfunction.
Okay. Yeah.
So from which you should be able to recover everything, right?
Yeah, that's what people doing better than that have told for the last 60 years. Technically, you write the wave function and you can recover everything. It took 70 years to compute one correlation function out of it. No, just to say, it's not because you know the spectrum that you can get the correlation functions. Even the wave function. So. No, but I fully agree. I'm happy of what you say. I'm just saying I think this is interesting question. Clearly, quasi-periodic has some resurgence, for example, in the decay of the wave function. So how it influence or doesn't influence localization property, I think it's an interesting question.
It was very, very recent about spins and local
yeah. Yeah, and just to...
Last year.
Yeah, sorry.
So you mentioned, so I'm confused because I thought that we were just told that there is no phase transition in lower dimensions.
No, but here I'm not even talking about a phase... Here?
You say close to the transition, you want an efficient way to
compute. Here. For example, this would be D equal 3.
I see. So you are going to move us up.
Yeah, I'm just saying that I would... Clearly, we are not very good in computing things either in the localized regime in any dimension, except 1D, where I would say the numerics is really powerful. But even in 2D, you saw that if I want to get the localization length in 2D, I am not so good. Okay, it can be done, but it's not super fantastic. But for example, the type of things which are measured here, the multifractality and so on, you would like powerful technique to extract it. And if you are in 3D, there is the outstanding question of the behavior around the transition,
right,
which
so
is there.
In that picture that you just showed, your own numeric, so the page 12 there.
Yes.
There does look like there's some kind of sharp transition in 1D.
No. So it's not a transition. It's just a crossover, and it's a sharp crossover in the system. So again, if the disorder becomes very, very small, or if the energy of the particle becomes very very small, okay, this is the top edge of the spectrum. So when you're passing this thing, you're entering a regime which is dominated by rare events, by Lifshitz tails. So this is not a transition. No, there is no transition in 1D as it should. Yeah. Okay, so let me just finish by one additional complication, and then I'll shut up. And of course, if you want one glorious complication, it's to add back the interactions in this study. So for waves, of course, this means nonlinear term, which would be like a psi 4 term in the energy. And of course, for particles, let's say, this would be interactions between the particles. And there is one last, and of course, these two are essentially the same. Don't get me wrong. And finally, there is one question which people are excited very much at the moment, which is the question of ergodicity. Because if you have a system which is localized, then the system cannot really explore all the phase space that it has at its disposal, and in particular at finite temperature, it's an interesting question on whether if you prepare the system in such a state, at finite temperature, the system will be able to thermalize, to properly explore all the phase space, or whether because of the localization, it can stay confined and refuse the ergodic possibility. And people have explored both theoretically and experimentally this thing. Just to stimulate you a little bit, I'll give the whole transparency, but let me just show you. Here is an experiment which is done in the group of Massimo Inguccio in Florence and Giovanni Modugno here. Massimo Inguccio is here. And this is an experiment done in 1D bosonic tubes with a biperiodic potential. So by using two pair of lasers, they superimpose two cosines with this incommensurate period that we were discussing. And we helped a little bit with the theory. So Guillaume Roux and Thomas Bartel are the people who did the theoretical interpretation of this. But essentially, here is the phase diagram. And I'll explain what it is, and I'll finish with that. This is the strength of the second potential, so think of it as the strength of the disorder here. And this axis is an interaction strength. So you get a bunch of bosons, so a bunch of particles, which are repelling each other. And this particle now interact. And what is measured here is essentially how superfluid is the system. So how delocalized, if you want, is the system? This is a measure of the width of the single particle correlation function. And what you see here, and I don't want to go into details, is that there is, at zero interaction, this is the Aubry-André model, so there is a transition between a delocalized regime and a localized regime here that is observed experimentally with the limitation of finite temperature and so on of the experiment. And then interaction help to delocalize the problem. So actually, in that case, you can go from a localized regime, But when you put interaction between these bosons, you can go to a delocalized regime. And if you increase further the interaction, you relocalize the problem. So repulsive interaction between the bosons, absolutely. So in that particular case, you see that there is a deep modification of the phase diagram, which would be delocalized, localized from here into a phase diagram where the delocalized phase has extended. But then if you put too much repulsion between the bosons, where the bosons can be localized even for an harmonic component, which is smaller than the one for the non-interacting. So this is a very difficult set of problems, but I think also a very interesting one. So on that, I think I will just put forward the slide of conclusion. I think I've said what were the questions which are at least personally excite me. And here is the summary. So I stop here, and I thank you for your attention. Yeah?
So about the last experiment you were speaking of, I have a question. So you have the interaction.
Yeah.
Right? So what states are we looking at? I mean, when you say localized, delocalized, what are we actually looking at?
No, no. So of course, this was, I didn't want to go into details. So what is measured here? Is the average, okay, is the average, sorry, it's not the average. What is measured is the quantum average of the n of k. So the probability. Ah, on voit pas l'écran. Ah oui, ça c'est sûr, c'est pas terrible. Let's do it that way. See. Okay, so what is measured here is the so-called single particle correlation function or momentum distribution. So this is the probability of finding a particle with momentum k.
In which state? So it's in the ground state?
In the thermodynamic state, which corresponds to the finite temperature of the experiment.
Oh, okay.
So this is, if you want, the trace.
It's a Gibbs state at a given temperature.
Exactly. So exponential of minus beta h of nk,
okay.
1 over z, and that's what is measured. So for a pure system in 1D at finite temperature, this would be essentially a narrow Lorentzian-like thing. So what is plotted here is the width of the distribution. So when this width is small, you could say I am delocalized. When this width is becoming very large, you could say, okay, it's because my wave function decreases exponentially, then the width would be controlled by the localization length. So the width would become essentially 1 over xi if you're localized, while it would be 1 over t, roughly, if you're delocalized. And if the temperature is small enough, you could expect that this width is super small. If the temperature is 0, this width is 0. Yes. Yes. So, now for fermions, the momentum distribution would be a step function, and then you have to use other measure like the transport to decide. But here also they did transport, but I don't. We can discuss this. They measured also the response to a current which is passed through the system.
Is there really a temperature in this experiment?
Unfortunately, yes. Eh, we may. Not in this one. Okay, we can discuss this, but the short story is that because they want the Aubry-André model, they have to put this huge lattice, which kills the kinetic energy in their system, and then the temperature becomes a nuisance. So what they should have done is to remove these two lattices here and put a speckle. And then the temperature would not be a problem.
Okay, because in our experiment,
no, I know. I know. And but for this experiment, yes, it's a problem. It's a problem. Are there? Then, my pleasure.